Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone. And welcome to the fifth installment of Clipple's ongoing free webinar series, Acoustical Testing of Sound System Equipment According to IEC 60268-21. Thankfully, I write that down. Today's installment brings together some great concepts discussed in episodes 1 through 4 and is entitled Maximum SPL, Giving This Value Meaning. My name is Kent Peterson, coming to you from Workwin in St. Paul, Minnesota. This may be of special interest to those of you out there performing measurements on powered or active systems. Calibrating the input stimulus to the output results is always challenging, and hopefully you can use some of the techniques described today in your workflow. We'll also have another live demo. Those are always fun to do live, so stick around and see how the measurements go in front of a live audience. Woohoo! As always, we'll have a question and answer session after the presentation. Please use your Q&A button to mark your questions so we can line them up accordingly. For first-time attendees, we also include some polling. I think today we have one poll. Please respond. It's completely anonymous, even to us. Also, we finally have the first 3 sessions up online for your viewing pleasure. And you are now able to pause, fast forward, reverse. You can find those links on the registration page as you scroll down to the previous sessions. As things begin to open up in this world, I hope your business remains strong and your work constant. I'm looking forward to seeing some of my workmates in person and getting out of the house a bit more. It has been decided in this household that I would not be a good starship or a submarine captain, as I'm going a bit crazy, and my crew is already starting to mutiny. I am no longer allowed to have the TV remote. Is that right? Yeah, that's right. Okay, let's get the learning started. Please allow me to turn the presentation over to Dr. Clipple. Good afternoon, Wolfgang. I hope all is well, and please take it away.
Thanks, Kent. Let's start with our webinar today. But first, I would like to give a very short overview. Our first session was modern equipment needs output-based testing. Here you see the idea. We get an SPL max, and we are determining a corresponding input signal. Then we showed in the second one how we are doing standard acoustical tests in a normal office. So we end up with some coefficients from the wave expansion, and now we can actually predict the sound pressure anywhere outside the scanning surface. That's very convenient because we are using this information as reference data to calibrate, I would say, our measurement setup, coming up with a compensation function, which is used here in a filter to generate simulated free field and far field condition by using the microphone very close to the speaker and having a very bad acoustical environment. What you see here in this picture, that's just my office. And now here's a microphone, the test microphone, that's a small Bluetooth speaker. And now we would like to calibrate here the input signal to generate in the in 1 meter distance that's predicted here. You see it later on the regular evaluation point, which is different than the microphone position. Here we are generating our rated SPL max. Yeah, and you will see this maximum SPL is a very important number. That's our topic today. It is rated, so the manufacturer, maybe you, has the freedom to define a meaningful number, but it is very much related to the stimulus. So the stimulus plays today a very important role. We go into the details there, and I hope it's quite interesting for you. So we are presenting some well-known characteristics from the stimulus and some new ones. Maybe you know the crest factor. We will speak a little bit about the kurtosis, which is very powerful. Maybe you like it. And then we are coming to the practical part to calibrate the input channel, based on the SPL max. And I show it in a practical way I hope everything is running well. The last time I had some technical problems. I hope I can do it much better today. Okay, here you see this slide is already discussed in the first webinar. What is the idea? Someone has rated the SPL Max, and in the calibration process, we are finding the right input voltage. Here in Europe, in Germany, we are using U for that, as a maximal input voltage for a certain input channel, for a certain set of the control parameters in an active system. That works always. That means SPL Max is a primary characteristic. It works for passive system, active system, any input channel. It can cope with any setting of the equalizers and limiters here in the system. But we need for many measurements the voltage, the secondary characteristic. You like it, for instance, for passive systems, for transducers, because the terminal voltage is quite convenient. But sometimes if this channel here is calibrated, it is also nice to replace our calibration stimulus, which should be broadband, by a sinusoidal signal, multitone, or any other thing. Yeah. So this is good. We have spoken about this for passive system. It depends on the particular setup. Yeah, and of course, then you can go back to the SPL Max. Another slide, we discussed this, but we need this today. That is who determines the SPL max value. That's actually the manufacturer, because he knows a lot of details from the physics behind the design and so on. And he also rates the measurement conditions. That means the stimulus, the position, and the environment. Yeah, I said already, we need this background information. That's actually one of the main messages here in our webinar, because this process is quite complex, and it is quite hard to have the same procedure for microspeakers, smartphones, and professional equipment, and so on. So we need some customization and some freedom for the manufacturer. But there are some fundamental requirements. The first is the DUT can really reproduce the output level. We see it today, that's a must. And the same DUT can handle this stimulus and not ours in a power test. So from the heat, from the mechanical load, the DUT should be capable of handling the device. What is the benefit? This number is meaningful for engineering, marketing, end user, and so on. Yeah, what are the rated conditions? That's, of course, maximum SPL level at the evaluation point. Here we covered in the first webinars here all those things like the acoustical environment. Here in our office, I'm generating now simulated free field condition, simulated far field condition. In reality, we are far away from that. Why? Because the room is bad, the distance is too short. Yeah? And now we are speaking about the stimulus. The stimulus for the calibration should be close to the typical program material and meaningful for the final application. And it should be a short signal, a deterministic signal. A signal maybe not longer than 1 second, but very convenient to calibrate in a few seconds the whole input channel. That's our goal. And the same signal is used for 100-hour testing. So that are some interesting requirements. Yeah, now the first poll. We have spoken about the 100-hour test, typical power test. What kind of test signals do you use for your testing? Theoretically, you can use a single tone. Maybe you tried that. If you are doing that, please put it in. You can give multiple answers. So, of course, you can also use a sinusoidal chirp. That's very similar to the single tone, sinusoidal, but you are changing the frequency. So you are running through the audio band with a signal. So you are generating effectively a broadband signal. That depends a little bit from the sweep speed, but if you are averaging that and you're playing your job again and again, you end up effectively with a broadband signal. But more popular is, of course, random noise or a sparse multi-tone complex. That's a new idea that's actually used to have the same properties with a random noise, but to get some extra benefits. And finally, music. Now I think the data are ready. Let's share that. It's interesting that really there are some guys who are using a single tone. Clearly, if you are working on subwoofers in a narrow frequency band and you are playing a sinusoidal tone where the peak values and the bottom values are, occur quite frequently, then you have then you are generating a very high mechanical load on your driver. So that's actually an aggressive test, much more aggressive than random noise. Yeah, the chirp has the same properties, but you can cover a wider frequency range. But most of the people, I expected that almost 60% use random noise, and maybe in the future they will also like the multi-tone. I think so. Yeah, and what is quite interesting, we have 23%, that's one quarter, are using music or music-like signals, sections of music usually. We have a very bad music example, which is real music. It's called Box Killer or something like that, or maybe it's only a name someone here in the company invented for that. So it is a very, very aggressive signal also. Okay, let's go on. The standard IEC 62-68-21 requires for the calibration and for the 100-hour test a broadband signal. And you see, we need at least a chirp to realize this with a single tone. That means a tone occurs at a certain time only at one frequency. We can do it the same with a two-tone chirp. With a multi-tone complex, then we get already some interactions between the different tones. Then we make a dense, just filling all the frequencies with tones, and we end up with noise. Both are or appear like random or pseudo-random. And finally, we have the audio signal. You see the complexity is rising. Yeah, we are focusing today on the multi-tone complex noise and audio signal a little bit. So we have a broadband signal. We consider, that means we need that to consider all the SPL frequency dependency in our device. So the peaks and dips in the frequency response, and we have to activate all transducer nonlinearities. So by having a dense broadband or broadband signal, at least, we are activating all nonlinearities. And we get maybe, if the shaping is correct, a typical heating of our device. And the same for the cooling. We get typical cooling effects, convection cooling, because we are pumping air through the gap, which is a very nice cooling effect. Yeah, and we would like to activate all the DSP functionality in the software, like limiting compressors and active protection in a typical way. What are the examples? We can use simulated program material. There's a table in the 21, how to shape the pink noise signal to generate that. We have a similar signal from the CDA standard. We have a new signal proposed by Meyersound. I'm speaking about that, M-noise. We have a multi-tone complex, which is now recommended by the new standard 21. And of course, you can use any selected audio material, music, and so on, and others.
We're having slight technical difficulties. Can you try turning your video off and immediately back on again?
My video. Yeah, okay, we have some technical problems, so I have to switch off here my video and video M. Do you see me? Or with the slides, do we?
No.
Yeah. Ken, do you see here my slides?
I do, yes.
And do you see my, maybe my face is not so important.
Yes, I can still see your face. It's lovely.
Okay. Andrew, can we go on? So, sorry, it's live. I got accustomed more or less to technical problems now. So let's go on. No, I have to go to that here. We are speaking now about the stimulus. So it's quite important. So the manufacturer has to state that. It should be broadband, but he has a lot of freedom using pink or white noise, dense or sparse. There are many ways. But he should also specify the upper and lower limits of the frequency band. That's important if you are testing transducers or subwoofers or something like that. Then it is very convenient to apply a shaping, maybe your own shaping or using here the typical program material. You have to speak about the crest factor. It is also recommended to add some kurtosis information if you have, but there we have still a lot of freedom for modifying the stimulus, and that's now our topic, to use this freedom in the best way. Okay, let's speak first about the spectral distribution. We can measure the power spectrum, maybe simplified in 1/3 octave bands, or in octave bands, that's very rough. You have the possibility to specify the upper and lower limits of the rated frequency range, more or less a bandpass function, and you can apply here a shaping function to that. So that's simple. Now it becomes a little bit more complicated. That's the amplitude distribution. That's actually a histogram over voltage here. That's a positive voltage, negative voltage. And this value here, the PDF, the probability density function, tells you how often we find this kind of amplitude. It's clear we are mostly about zero in music. For a music signal, we are 99% close to the zero value, but sometimes we have very high negative and positive peaks. The sinusoidal signal is more aggressive than the other signals. You see it. We are usually or very frequently at the negative peak and at the positive peak. Yeah, if you would like to have a simpler and you would not to use this PDF function, then we are speaking about the peak values, the RMS values, which are usually here, as the root mean square values. If we are dividing peak and RMS value, we end up with the crest factor, and we can generate some higher order moments. That's a kurtosis. That's new, maybe for you, but I'm speaking about this soon. Oh, okay, let's go on with the temporal properties. Maybe you have stationary conditions. You take your pink noise generator and it generates almost the same signal. And if you are doing an autocorrelation, you are correlating different sections of the signal with each other, you find in an ideal analog generator almost no correlation with the noise. But if you are using or playing the signal again and again, then you have a high autocorrelation. So maybe that's close to the periodicity of the signal. Yeah, and then you can apply some modulation. You can switch it on, you can switch it off, and you can also apply some stepping. Here you see in the breaks, that's off cycles where the temperature in red drops down, but with the stepping, we have increased the amplitude. So that are more or less the temporal properties. I have seen, by the way, that someone hold his hand. That means please write a message here, a chat to Kent, and we will discuss this soon. Okay. Basic signal characteristics. You should know that. Let's assume we have Gaussian noise. It looks like a Gaussian curve here in the PDF. Yeah. Or we have music. It's a little bit more picky here. That's the only difference. And with the sinusoidal wave, we have this bathtub curve. And now we are calculating the RMS value. That's quite simple. We are squaring the signal. Then we are averaging the squared value and taking the root from that to come to the RMS value. Okay, we can do the same with the amplitude distribution. Now we are using here the PDF as a weighting function, weighting the instantaneous amplitude. It's clearly that the high values here and here are scaled with a lower value, while the zero position is scaled with a higher value. But zero does not contribute to the RMS value. So that means those values here have the highest impact on the RMS value. Okay, we call it a second order moment. That's it, because it's squared here. Yeah, and then we have the peak value, which is quite simple. We take the absolute value of this of the signal and searching for the maximum value in a certain time period. And here you see already the problem. While here all the signals are considered with, I would say, with a weighting function, here it's also averaged. Here we are searching for a single value. We get some statistical problems. But anyway, crest factor is a simple thing and we like it. We are, and it has its place clearly. We are dividing this peak value by the RMS value and end up with the crest factor, usually in dB. Okay, now to the IEC standard 268-21 about simulated program material. Here you see the typical arrangement in the appendix how to generate that. We start usually, that's a conventional technique, with pink noise, with a Gaussian distribution. Then we are doing the shaping, maybe here with a simulated program material, and then we end up with this probability density function. Yeah, actually, if we have an analog generator, it is not very likely, but it's possible that we have any peak value here. Yeah, it goes on forever. That's why we need a clipping device, which cuts the negative and positive signals at a certain point, and we are in increasing here at this point, actually the PDF, you will see it. That's cutting out. And here we get a small increase in the PDF. Why? Because everything what was here in the gray region is now located here at this end. So we end up with a little bit strange probability density function if we are doing that with a very low crest factor. But anyway, that's a simple way. Just by changing here's the signal, we are shifting, we are enhancing our signal. We are working here with fixed boundaries from our clipping device, and now we can realize any desired crest factor. But the PDF looks very strange if we are setting the crest factor very low. Anyway, that's a way to have a controlled crest factor. That's important for the power amplifier. Why? By doing so, we can save money. You can use power amplifier, which has less high peak voltage requirements or capabilities. So that means by using that, maybe 12 dB, you know exactly what is a peak voltage coming out from this chain here, and you can select the right power amplifier for to submitting the signal to the network on the loudspeaker without additional limiting. That's quite important to have a defined amplitude at the amplifier output, maybe at the network filter or at the loudspeaker. What are the problems? Any network filter and even the loudspeaker will change the crest factor significantly. Why is that? If we are changing the phase relationship between the different tones in the broadband signal, we end up in the time signal with a different waveform, and you get you go back to the about 12 dB crest factor from normal noise. Okay, from Gaussian noise. So that means this is illustrated here. Maybe at the terminal voltage, you have a smoothed PDF and still a higher peak value. But the energy is still in the signal, so it's not so bad. Now we are coming to the question, how important is the crest, or meaningful is the crest factor? Here you see it depends on the statistics and on the time. You are waiting, and if you are waiting a little bit longer, you get usually a higher crest factor. So that depends really from the observation time. And that's why you end up with a relatively high variance here in the crest factor measurement on typical audio signals. So that's a weakness of the crest factor. So this signal also evaluates only the very rare signals. So it's less suitable for really assessing the heating and some mechanical load problems, fatigue and aging. Why? Because if you have a very short peak, maybe every 30 seconds, 5 seconds, 10 seconds, then it makes maybe less harm than this signal here, which occurs maybe every 50 milliseconds or every 100 milliseconds. So that's our problem. So we need a more robust statistical characteristic. And that's the kurtosis. And it's quite simple. Please be not shocked for the short equation. This equation is not difficult. It's very similar to the RMS calculation, but here we have, instead of the squaring, we have the fourth order, and we are normalizing the signal by the calculated RMS value, and then we are calculating the mean value. So it's relatively simple. And you can calculate the same with the PDF. We have here the normalized displacement, normalized to the RMS value, set it to the fourth power. That's why we call it the fourth standardized moment, and weighting that with the PDF. That's it. And how can we interpret that? That's quite simple. Kurtosis is a measure of the variance of the dispersion of X, or this displacement here, voltage, around the RMS value. So if this here is the RMS value, then you see this is the variance here is quite, say, medium. Why? Because it could be, here the peaks could be, or here for the Brown curve, for the noise, it's much larger. Yeah, in other words, the shoulder here is the RMS value, and we are asking how or if the kurtosis becomes higher if more energy is here at the center or in the tails. No. That's illustrated here on a variety of signals. Let's start with music. Music has usually the highest kurtosis from our signals here. It is quite peaky here, so we have high peaks, and most of the time we are still here close to zero. So we end up with a kurtosis of 6, and then it goes down. With Gaussian noise, we get always a kurtosis of 3. Even if you are killing here with a limiter some peaks, or reducing them, then they have not much influence on the total kurtosis. So usually you end up with a kurtosis of 3. Okay, here if you are generating such a signal, you need some strange compressor for doing that. Then you have a kurtosis of 2. And now this is a next interesting test signal. That's a sawtooth wave. Yeah, with a lot of harmonics here. But the nice thing is, on the amplitude, we have always the same probability, or in the histogram, we have always the same likelihood for occurrence of of an amplitude in this region. We are jumping very quickly here to the other side, and then we are going exactly in the same way over the amplitude. So that's a sawtooth. That's a sinusoidal wave here with a bathtub characteristic. And finally, we have a square wave. We are only on the RMS value, on the positive, on the negative one, here in the green one, sorry. And then we have the lowest kurtosis at one. So here you see that are quite interesting test signals. In a certain way, they are more aggressive or more relaxed to our speaker. That's quite important. Yeah, now let's discuss what is typical. Actually, I recommend this PhD thesis. It's old. I got this tip here from Laurie Fincham. He was involved in that. Maybe he was a tutor or he worked at CAF at that time. And it's a very nice analysis of popular and classical music at that time. You know, maybe it has changed from all kinds of different things. And here you see the values of the kurtosis and the crest factor. And the interesting point is it is related. Yeah. So the conclusion is a larger variance found in the crest factor and the kurtosis, of course, of the music, but that comes from the different music here. So it's quite complex what happens in different kinds of music. But if the crest factor rises, the kurtosis usually rises also. But here we have a very long observation time. So that means they defined here the peak value by the, that means the number of the occurrence when the peak value is larger at a certain value. That's typical academic, it's from the PhD. But if you have a shorter observation time, that means it happens more frequently, then you see we have much lower crest factor, only 13. But if you wait a little bit longer, you come up to 27. You see, you have to define how you define your peak value. So that's a little bit tricky. No? Yeah, that means it depends on the observation time, but the kurtosis is quite reliable. It's very easy to define that. It's like an RMS value. Yeah, other particularities of music. Here you see an interesting result from Meyer Sound. They found out, based here for the crest factor, that the crest factor for normal music is rising at higher frequencies. Pink noise, Gaussian noise, is not doing that. So that means, we have at lower signals a lower crest factor. We find it also in the voice count displacement if you are measuring that. Why? Because the loudspeaker, it behaves like a low pass by transforming the input voltage into the voice count displacement. So that means we know already there are some other authors which have reported about that, that we have a very typical crest factor usually in the displacement. Here that's quite low, between 10 and 15 dB. But at higher frequencies, we have a higher one. That's maybe caused by the percussion instruments generating impulsive components at higher frequencies. Yeah, what are the consequences? The consequences is that increases the peak voltage and it's important for the amplification, for the power amplifier. If you would like to learn more about that, go to this website, and there's a nice movie over there, and study that. We have not much time for going on to that. Okay, what is to do at a later time? We have to do the same measurements with the kurtosis in bands. We are working on that. But now let's speak about the practical consequences. Think about you have your stimulus, you have a voltage spectrum, and here is your loudspeaker system with a transducer. And the first question is really to look to the voltage at the terminals. And here we have to cope with the amplifier. And actually, to consider all the amplifier problems, it is good to just focus on the peak values of the voltage. That means the crest factor is a very nice metric characteristic to cope with this problem, 100%. Yeah, and then we can also calculate the kurtosis and use that for the evaluation of our transducer, or maybe we ask the question, are the nonlinearities activated in our transducer, are any, or in the limiter or compressor, and what kinds of distortions are generated. So, and of course we have here also the RMS values and the power, that's quite nice for heating and thermal overload. You see that that something is missing. That is actually fatigue and aging in the mechanical domain. To speak about that, we need the displacement. We can easily calculate that from the lower spectrum from the stimulus. And we should really also measure here the probability density function of the displacement. Then we have not the voltage like here, we have here now the displacement in millimeter, no? Okay, and this is here the critical area where we are stressing our transducer, where we are generating aging and fatigue. And now actually this measures here also the peak and the kurtosis are the important parameters for actually investigating or describing mechanical overload, fatigue and aging, and also activating the nonlinearities. So that's more or less the relationship and the practical consequences for the audio device. And then of course here the power spectrum, that's similar here to those energetic measurements and the RMS displacement values. And maybe the apparent mechanical power, that's the power flowing into the suspension and going out into the suspension. We have not the time of speaking about that. Okay, now let's summarize this. We need a standard test signal, we like it. Here we get from the noise, from the audio signal, nice random properties. It is maybe, especially from noise, stationary. Here from the audio signal, it's non-stationary. Here with a multitone, we get some pseudo-random properties. That's also very convenient because we are sure that our crest factor is under control. So if we have a pseudo-random, maybe relatively short 3 seconds or 10 seconds, we play it again and again, we know there will be never a higher peak value in displacement or in voltage. Okay, and we have our deterministic signal. What is important? Comparability, reproducibility, repeatability. We like a deterministic stimulus. We get no problems with the power amplifier. And that's why pseudo-random properties are good. Sometimes we have to represent a typical program material. Sometimes we will kill our transducer. We will stress our transducer. Then we need an aggressive program material causing those defects. Yeah, and then we are using that for 100 hours, so it should be convenient and simple for endurance testing, reliability testing, climate insurance, and we need it at the same time for a very short calibration, maybe 1 second. Here you see there's now a conflict, and that's why here's a multitone signal comes in. And we would like to doing some more monitoring during the long-term testing, distortion measurements, compression testing. We need this very soon. And to measure internal states like displacement and temperature. Yeah. Mm. So, okay, that's why we will come to a multitone. I'm coming very soon to back to that. But now let's speak a little bit more about the calibration routine. I have spoken already about that. Here we have our SPL max. We are finding now the right UMAX by scaling more or less here our generator signal. It should be fast, very fast as we can. We would like to use that signal for the calibration of other signals from other generators, maybe. We would like to apply it for any other input terminal, and it should be quite simple and so on. Yeah, so that's why this standard recommends a multi-tone stimulus for this purpose. Yeah, what are the advantages? It's pseudo-random. By the way, you can generate this with a few parameters that's described in the standard. So you don't need a WAV file. You need just a simple generator, and we can also provide this for free for generating to that, or any other manufacturer of measurement equipment will implement that. So that's free and open and very well defined. It is nice for fast testing. In 1 second, you can calibrate the input, you measure the distortion, and you can measure also very fast the time constant, even in a micro speaker in a smartphone. You can use it also for 100 hours by looping the signal multiple times. And yet now it comes, you can interlace multiple multi-tones for measuring multiple dots in one room. I'm coming back to that, so that's quite nice. Yeah, some words to the multi-tone, if you are not familiar with that. We are using multiple tones with usually a certain distance. That is on a logarithmic frequency scale, it has the same distance. So in one octave, we have usually the same number of lines. And the measured signal has usually some noise in it, which is not excited by the generator, and some nonlinear distortion, very convenient for distortion measurements. We can cut out the fundamental or calculate from the fundamental the total SPL. We are doing that. Or you can also investigate the distortions from the remaining signal. So it's quite convenient. The signal is now very well defined in the standard. Yeah, and now we are coming to the interlaced multi-tone testing. Think about you have active systems. Maybe you have a different way for providing the stimulus to the signal, asynchronous with a wave player inside, analog, or maybe with Bluetooth. But the interesting point is each speaker here gets a different signal. It has maybe the same, almost the same shaping, or the same shaping, but the tones are at different positions. They are interlaced, and you know where the frequencies are from each tone. And now you can easily separate them in the analysis, and you get for each speaker an amplitude response or a spectrum. And from that, you see immediately the change in the transfer response, and you see what is failing. Maybe the tweeter is failing or heating more than the other one. So it's very convenient. This is the main reason why everybody will like the multi-tone in testing. So if you would like to make it more dense, you can just put more lines into that as you like. And if you fill it up, you end up with a noise-like signal. No? What is not possible, that's the only disadvantage. If you are interlacing the stimulus, you cannot measure the distortion. That makes no sense. All of the, even if you have some free lines here, or you cannot find out which speaker has generated the distortion. Okay, now it's time for a practical demo, or maybe a short question. I think we should handle one or two questions if we have one, which are related to the topic.
I haven't seen any questions yet.
Well, then I go on.
I
hope I'm not too fast. I go immediately here to the measurement. Here you see we are using the M tone. I switch on here the, let's see, and make it a little bit larger that you see it. We are now here in this session part 5, and we are using here a multi-tone measurement in situ. We have here, please Andrew, switch on here the camera that you see our setup. This is here our test microphone. That's in 30 centimeter distance. That's our speaker. Please turn the camera to the left side. The actual evaluation point is on the edge of the table. And we are now generating in the second step here simulated far field and free field condition. But now first we start here doing a measurement just at this point. I start some before I'm doing that, I'm speaking a little bit to switch it off. Yeah, I think, yeah, about our stimulus. It's a multi-tone stimulus, and we have here actually 12 lines per octave. And this is here one octave, and you see that there are approximately 12 lines. That's 1/3 octave level. And if you're integrating or collecting the energy from multiple lines, we end here with the octave level, no? Okay, it is simulated, it is shaped here by the ESIC standard. That's here, it's a typical shaping curve. And you see it goes down at higher frequencies and at lower frequencies. Okay, that's our stimulus. And here we see interesting results. We are considering the total band from 18 hertz, as a 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. Our signal duration is 1 hertz, 1 second long. And our kurtosis value is about 3. And we have a crest factor about 13 dB. That's very typical. Okay, let's make this measurement here without directly at this point. I repeat here the measurement. Oh, the loudspeaker was not switched off. I have to activate that. Maybe I have changed a little bit the position. Let's redo that. First, we are measuring the noise. Here you see that's here our, that's our stimulus, and that's our recorded sound pressure signal. It is quite rough. That are here the room resonances. And that is here the noise level. I was quiet during the measurement, but we see already at 30 centimeter distance that we get here, no, we get about 50 dB signal to noise ratio. That's sufficient. About this stuff here, that are the distortion, we are speaking the next time. Okay, that's more or less our spectrum. That's our probability density function. You see it's synthesized with a multitone. So we have really here a very distinct peak value that's stable. If I repeat the measurement, we have always the same crest factor. And that's a bad thing. We have here a very high deviation, about 15, 20 dB due to the room resonances. So that's not a free field measurement. But we can generate that. That's our next step here in the second measurement. We have done this or discussed this the last time. I'm cleaning up my screen a little bit. This is here an imported near field measurement from the near field scanner. And then we did in the last session a first measurement in the room. Here you see the bad properties of the room, that about 15 to 20 dB. That's not the speaker. That here, that's the speaker, and the decay is the speaker. But we could by using the reference data from the scanner, we could generate here a room correction curve, and I took here the room correction curve and imported them. Maybe I can do it here again. Here under routing, here is the in-room correction function from the clipboard. I take it into the multi-tone measurement, and then I can start the measurement. So it's much more flat. here you see it. Here this small variation is caused because when I switched on here the device again, the Bluetooth device, I changed a little bit the position of the device. So that you see we are very sensitive with any mismatch of the position of the device. So, okay, that's more or less our first step to synthesize artificial free field, far field condition. Also, the level is now adjusted that it corresponds with a 1 meter distance here on with the evaluation point. So, and now let's check a little bit the influence with from the stimulus. This measurement is identical with the previous one. Let's look to the level. Here we have about 70.6 dB total SPL with the stimulus, and now I'm doing only one thing. I'm limiting the frequency band from 200 hertz to 7 kilohertz and using a different stimulus. The stimulus, I have to do it. It sounds a little bit different. We have less bass, less high frequency signals. Here you see it's band limited, and now we have 1.5 dB more output. So you see already by changing something on stimulus, you can dramatically change your output. That's why it's so important that we have a very simple signal which can be easily synthesized or can be given by as a wave file to your to anybody else. Okay, I'm going back to the to some slides here in my presentation. And now we are here on the calibration routine. There are two methods. Here's the first method, quite simple. You have a fixed voltage here from the generator, but you have a very convenient internal gain controller in your device. For this Bluetooth, it is device, it's not convenient. We have here 2 dB steps. We have not the resolution to exactly generate the right SPL max value. That's why I skipped that. So, but if you have an analog gain controller, it's maybe quite convenient, yeah, to generate the desired thing. We prefer here today as a second method. So that means we put just the Bluetooth at maximal gain internally. So this is constant here. And now I'm adjusting here the multi-tone signal inside our measurement tool and searching for the right UMAX for the standard condition stated by the manufacturer. It's quite simple. Yeah, now we are ready for this demonstration. I'm using the same tool. I have to go to that. I close that one and that one. And now we are here in the input calibration. I go to the first tool and I'm doing first one thing what is usually not allowed. In the standard, it is said that you should make a pause, a break between the measurement because maybe the loudspeaker can heat up. I know this Bluetooth device very well. I know we have no thermal problems. So that's why I make this pause here at zero. Maybe I should activate here that here. So the pause is zero. I use no averaging, it's one. I use one pre-loop to have a complete, I'm playing that twice with a pre-loop and with the final measurement, and the measurement time is 1 second, so quite short. And I'm doing that here over the full frequency range with the same signal. So I switch that off here, that's too confusing. Okay. And now, what is interesting, I forgot to say that we have a target value. We have a target value, SPL max, given, rated by the manufacturer of 74 dB, as a 74.5 dB. So I entered that, and now I made the previous measurement in the other measurements here at a lower one. So we are a little bit down 3 dB, but now I'm starting here. Also my start value is it should be here. No, it is maybe 20 dB down. It is safe in the safe region. It is derived automatically from the maximum voltage in the small signal domain, maybe a tenth of that, I think so. Now let's do it. You see we are repeating the measurement until we end up with the target SPL. I have to clean up my screen and make a double click here. Now we have reached our target. Also we got with an Umax of 0.17 volt, we get just our 74 dB output. Yeah, we have here our almost smooth response. And here you see quite nicely the compression versus the voltage during the test. Yeah, we started here with a tenth of the maximum voltage. Yeah, okay, I'm maximizing that. I do it. Here we started at 0. Also, the window, that's easier. Okay, we don't need that. I can close that. So that means that's the voltage here. We started here at 50 millivolts. That was the first step. And then we found already some compression. So the region was, so the steepness was different. And finally, we found here the right maximum voltage of 170 millivolts. That's it. We can, I can just for fun, start here another measurement where I have a break of 4 seconds in it. That's just necessary if you know your loudspeaker is heating. So you see there are always 4 seconds for cooling in between. Here we see how the level is rising in the spectrum. That was the first measurement. It's 50 millivolts. Maximum compression. Aha, now I have spoken or something happens here. No, that was a disturbance at very low frequencies, maybe from some noise from me. And that was interpreted as compression. That's why it stopped automatically. So here are some protection limits in it. Sorry, that's not a big deal. We come to that in a later webinar. Okay, now I'm switching back to the slides. No, that's the wrong one. Here we are. I'm cleaning that here. And I think here you see, if we have the input voltage, we can nicely use now a different signal to that, using the same voltage, adjust that and doing our measurement. We will do it very soon in with other measurements. We can also reduce the level now to a tenth of the maximum voltage, then we have a clear definition of our small signal domain. That's quite nice. And we can avoid any unintended overload over the joint. Okay, now before I'm coming to the summary, we have time for questions.
Okay, we've got a lot of questions coming in. Let's start from the earliest. This question comes in, crest factor and peak. Would it not make sense to determine the average peak level in a given signal?
Why not? That means we are missing clear peak definitions and it should make sense for audio signals. So that means that was one problem which came up in the PhD thesis. So, and he discussed that. How to define the peak? And if for a steady state or for an artificial sinusoidal signal, it's easy. But already for Gaussian noise, for peak noise from an analog generator, it's impossible to define that because you get any theoretically, any peak value you like if you are waiting long enough. So that means for music, it depends now, how do you define that, and why should you not average different peak values or something like that in one music? Or better, I would make a good averaging of different crest factor determined. Also that is possible. But you end up with huge variations. That's one problem.
Interesting.
It's good for the amplifier. You have to check that always. So the crest factor makes a lot of sense for ensuring that you have selected the right amplifier. It makes a little bit of sense for displacement, because huge peak displacement will also kill the loudspeaker. So then it makes sense. But for long-term aging, fatigue, it has not much value, because the fatigue comes at a lower than the peak value, because it happens more often. Ooh, it has wonderful. A higher PDF. Okay.
Right. You don't want to blow up your speaker. You'll have nothing to test. The manufacturer has freedom to specify a lot, but doesn't this make it difficult to compare with other specifications from other manufacturers? An example would be a Bluetooth speaker. Would it not make sense to make an addendum to the standard proposing a standard setup for this group of devices?
Exactly.
We have a winner.
This standard was intended as, a basis standard, which avoids going into the details for a pro speaker for any smartphones and so on. And we have already a micro speaker standard, which is harmonized with the 21. Now Korea has started a new initiative for large TVs, which is based on the 21. And of course, the AES is thinking about having a standard for professional equipment. We should exactly do that, what you say.
Right, we're missing out on our AES this year. I think that'll be a virtual seminar. That'll be fun. What is a suitable pause time? Do we need to monitor the thermal condition? I think we do that in Clipple.
Very hot topic. I just finished in the preparation here webinar number 7. And you will like it, what happens in this context. That's about compression. And we are discussing all the thermal problems and the limiters and all that in this webinar. Wait.
That'll be a good one. There's a couple questions regarding the PWT module. Is this included in the PWT module? I know that's a hot topic, and people are waiting with bated breath.
Yeah, actually, we found out we are supporting the PVT always, but we found out it's not sufficient for the current time. So that the PVT was designed almost 15, 20 years ago, and now we are working on a completely new, endurance and power test landscape, which also includes here active and passive systems. And our goal is to use available equipment. There are some smart amplifiers available, or even professional amplifiers with voltage and current monitoring. So that means you get the whole, hardware infrastructure at a lower price. And that's why what we are doing here now, it's part of this new endurance landscape, generating the stimulus, doing some interlaced testing, but many things will be done with WAV files and with active systems and Bluetooth and something like that.
We get that question a lot, if they can put in their own stimulus. There are still a lot of questions coming in. I'll remind our attendees that there is a Q&A button at the bottom of the page.
Yeah,
some of them are coming in on chat, so it's difficult to keep them in line. Here's one going back to max voltage. What happens if the max voltage can't be reproduced by the DUT? Say I put in 130 dB SPL and the DUT can only reproduce 100 dB. Well, I imagine you're going to let the magic smoke out of the box.
Yes, that's one point. So if something like that happens, you should, that's why we have some maximum voltage inputs. We have some compression limits. Actually, you have seen we have stopped the measurement because the compression limit was activated. So you can put some protection limits apply to that, actually quite a lot, and then you are relatively safe to avoid that. But if you don't reach your SPR max, something is wrong. Maybe the manufacturer is a liar. It might happen. Maybe not. Maybe you have done something wrong with your microphone calibration or with the distance, or you have not read very careful his standard measurement condition. Yeah, there will be a lot of small printed stuff very soon, how to make the measurement and to prove that. And if you don't, if you cannot get the SPR max, you should call him and ask him.
Very good. An interesting one comes in about flat panel speakers with high deviations in the frequency response. For example, some peaks. If we shape our signal to these peaks that we drive to in the peaks, we can reach really high SPL max. Does this make sense in the comparison? I'm going to turn that one over to you because I'm not quite sure what the attendee is asking.
Of course, I put it in the category. I say it very badly, doing some tricks to get high SPL max. The point is, if you are shaping your stimulus in such a way to get for a particular loudspeaker very high SPL level, then everybody will say, why you are using such a strange stimulus? Is this a typical audio signal? Then you have to say, it's not, but I found it. It makes a lot of SPL for my speaker. So maybe it will be not accepted by someone else. I think there will be a tendency that maybe in 1, 2, 3, 5 years, we have a very well defined stimulus. Everybody likes that because many people are using that. We have some evidence that it represents somehow audio signal, but then many people have to do some measurements with the kurtosis, with the crest factor and other things on real music. So, and if we have this information, maybe we define in the next update of the IC standard here, the typical program material in a different way. And wonderful. Everybody likes that.
Wonderful. Okay. There is a comment. Somebody would like for you to comment on the fact that this commenter occasionally finds that the CF is occasionally confused with peak, as in increasing CF means higher peaks, which the contention that is that is wrong. Can you comment on that, Wolfgang?
That means peak and RMS value divided by each other gives the crest factor. So that means if you say our main thinking is about the RMS value, how much power, voltage, nominal power goes into the speaker, then the RMS value is set and a higher crest factor would generate higher peaks.
Agreed. Sort of a straight one-to-one, logarithmic calculation. What about cycling noise on and off at 1 minute for long-term power testing? Do you have any insight on that?
We are coming with a compression in detail to that.
Okay.
That's section 7. Don't miss that. That's quite interesting.
Don't miss it. It'll be very exciting. Why do you send a burst signal to measure max SPL instead of a sustained 30-second average?
You mean a burst, really the burst signal? That means 6 periods of a sinusoidal shaped, yes? This is a... I would say the shortest signal to measure harmonic distortion and to measure in a certain way the behavior of a compressor and a limiter. So that means we are coming also with a compressor, with an amplitude compression exactly to the burst signal, and then it is quite important.
Wonderful. Boy, they're sure coming at you. You're going to be here. I hope you have coffee. Is there a weighting component in the noise, A or C weighted, determine max SPL, or is it just a broadband measurement?
A weighted?
Yeah, if you weight, if you're weight, I suspect the question is, in your power testing, do you prefer to weight the signal?
To weight, A scale, weighting scale.
Or
yeah.
C weighting?
100%. Exactly. 100%. Full freedom to weight that. Oh, sorry, that's my... it's fine. You have full freedom to weight and to scale your signal, but you have to publish that. You have to state that with give it to the customer and so on.
Right, that's got to go in the spec. Mm-hmm. What is the spectrum shape of the M tone versus old IEC? When you stop increasing the level during SPL max test, how much is there a compression level involved in that?
Actually, we are keen to for doing some tests with the M tone. That's our agenda. But I have to admit, I have not started with that. So that means please submit this question to Meyer Sound. There is also an IS group who are working on the M sound. Maybe you find that, or you can also send it to me and I can forward that to this ES group. It's quite right. Interesting and they have to do it.
Yeah, we can supply you with some resources there. Feel free to email Klipple, info@klipple.de or info@workwin.com. Why the duration of 100 hours in the new spec compared to 2 hours in the old IEC?
Yeah, it's a reliability test. And there was always, think about that, we have still the short-term and long-term SPL. What was in the old ISC 6268-5, that was approximately two hours long. It still exists, but that is not the rated maximum SPL, what we mean for the calibration and for the main thing. And it might be that the two-hour test will be removed if with the next revision of the standard, we will ask in the national committees whether this is important or not, and because it's old.
I'd be curious how many out there are actually using a 100-hour test anymore. We do it rarely, but we are requested to do it from time to time.
The point is the responsibility, the manufacturer has a responsibility for the reliability. So if he is 100% sure from the background information that this SPL can be handled from the speaker, then he can skip that. For automotive, it would be not acceptable. And for maybe for smartphones, also not. I don't know.
Interesting. Yeah, well, I don't know how many people are OEMing in their transducers, but a lot of that 100-hour testing is done in the transducer manufacturing process.
Yeah, that means this information from the transducer, if this is the critical part, and they know very well that the amplifier can handle that and the DSP has also no problem, then they take the responsibility for that.
Right. There's a clarification question. In the module demonstrated today, the SPL target is the assumed SPL maximum the speaker is capable of. As reported by the manufacturer, can incremental increases of the target and subsequent reruns of the test be also used to determine max SPL of an active system?
To make it very clear, this is a rated characteristic, and the manufacturer has the freedom to rate any number. He would most likely he will rate it as high as possible. Then maybe he has some problems with the quality, with the sound quality. We are coming to the problem of doing a reasonable rating. We are coming to that. That's in session. It's really at the end, almost. It's session 14. Why? Because there are so many arguments and background information affecting this rating. We have to do it at the very end. For this speaker, this number here will not come from JBL and Harman. Actually, I rated this device just for this level because you will see it later. What was the reason why I use this this number? I think it makes a lot of sense. But for now, we cannot say more. So that means today we got this number from the manufacturer, we used that under the conditions, and we ended with a UMAX. That's it, up to now.
Very good. Is it possible to calculate the kurtosis of a signal in the time domain, as in continuously updating from the beginning to the end?
Yes, on the slide on the left side, when I introduced the kurtosis, there was one thing in the time domain, as a squaring, putting the signal to the fourth order, dividing the signal by the RMS value, and then this ratio will be set to the fourth power, and then it's averaged over some time, maybe.
Right. Very good. Looking forward to getting into that. A question came in about in the first or second session, we discussed the near field scanning double layer measurement technique.
Yes.
People curious about the underlying algorithm. I believe that is your secret recipe. But maybe we could provide a reference. You can find that reference if you go to the Klippel website and search near field scanner. We can also provide that information to you as well. We're welcome to do that. It is, I think it's groundbreaking work. There's one final comment here.
No, I would only to say the near field scanner is very convenient and accurate, but you can also do similar stuff, maybe not with the full accuracy, but maybe sufficiently for practical usage with the measurement on the parking lot on the ground floor and something like that.
Right. There is a white paper for that and an application note if you look on the Klippel website. I think that's about it. We're coming up on about an hour and 17. I think you'd probably like to wrap this up, Wolfgang, would you not?
Yeah, I would like. So let's summarize.
I will turn that over to you.
Okay. Do you see still my slide? Yeah.
I do. Yeah.
Yeah, very good. So the rated value SPR max depends on the properties of the selected broadband stimulus. And you see that's quite important. We need, in a certain way, the kurtosis for that. It's a new interesting characteristic. We should think about that and so on. So, of course, the crest factor, he will also survive. That's not a problem. But the kurtosis will be a nice substitute or alternative and additional, how do you say it? It complements the crest factor. That's the right saying. Yeah, the same stimulus is used for the calibration process and for the long-term testing. Why? If you, as a user, playing around with the device, you should be safe trying to realize this level. No, multi-tone stimulus is an interesting stimulus for doing that. Yeah. And the input calibration should be very fast. You have seen it a few seconds. Yeah, that's it. Yeah. And now we are ready actually for the large signal evaluation that starts with the next webinar. The next one, I'm speaking about the whole possibilities of doing different measurements which have a high diagnostic value. I have to clarify what are signal distortion. I'm speaking about linear, time variant, nonlinear, Rabin bus, and something like that. And a little bit about the critical things which limit the output and the SPR max. And then about how can we minimize the test effort and doing meaningful testing. That's quite interesting. And a little bit about the physics behind that. So a little bit about nonlinearities, but very simple that you get understand that. So please use the opportunity next week, selecting measurement with high diagnostic value. And then you see later on, we are discussing in detail. Amplitude compression in 7, harmonic distortion, intermodulation distortion, and imports of distortion.
See, we try to leave you with a cliffhanger, just like all the best shows on Amazon, and Netflix. There's your cliffhanger. Next week, we'll discuss amplitude compression. All right, let's get at it. Everybody remain safe as we begin to get our economies up and running. And I hope you're safe, Cliff. Wolfgang, did you want to mention anything else?
No, thank you for staying with me. I see I cannot do it in 45 minutes. So that was the fastest I can do. But I hope you like the material.
That's all right. Your voice is like a musical instrument. Everybody take care, and we'll see you here next week. And don't forget that you can find recordings of these sessions on the Clipple registration page. We're a little bit behind that, but we like to edit out all the goofy comments and some of our mistakes. So enjoy. We'll see you next week, and everybody stay safe. Bye-bye, everybody.
Goodbye.